This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Closing arguments are scheduled to begin today in the trial of accused sexual predator, movie mogul Harvey Weinstein. The jury is expected to begin deliberations on Tuesday. Weinstein faces five felonies, including rape and predatory sexual assault, based on accusations by two women. If convicted, he faces life in prison. The trial comes more than 2 years after initial accusations against the film producer were published in The New Yorker and The New York Times, sparking the Me Too movement that swept Hollywood and beyond. Since then, more than 100 women have accused Weinstein of rape, sexual assault, and sexual harassment. Weinstein has also been charged with rape in Los Angeles County. During the trial, six women told the jury in graphic detail about how Weinstein had sexually assaulted them. Weinstein did not testify, but his lawyers described the sexual encounters as consensual. His legal team repeatedly attempted to discredit the claims of the women. Last week, one of his accusers, Jessica Mann, broke down and went into an apparent panic attack during questioning from Weinstein's lawyers, forcing the judge to adjourn proceedings for the day. Jessica Mann was made to read past emails to a boyfriend in which she disclosed she had been sexually assaulted before meeting Weinstein. She accuses Weinstein of raping her in New York and Los Angeles and said she had an extremely degrading relationship with him. While the trial centers on the accusations of two women, many other women who were victimized by Weinstein have attended the trial. In early January, the actor Rosanna Arquette spoke outside the courthouse.
As we stand here at the beginning of a new year and a new decade, time's up. Time's up on sexual harassment in all workplaces. Time's up on blaming survivors. Time's up on empty apologies without consequences. And time's up on the pervasive culture of silence that has enabled abusers like Weinstein.
We're joined now by two guests. Here in New York, Jay Clara Chan is with us, media and politics reporter at The Wrap, where she's been covering the Weinstein trial every day. And joining us in Los Angeles is Louise Godbold, executive director of ECHO, which provides training to trauma survivors and those who support them. The group is hosting a conference for trauma survivors, including Weinstein survivors, next month called And Still We Rise. Godbold wrote a blog post titled My Encounter with Harvey Weinstein and What It Tells Us About Trauma. We're going to start, though, with you, Clara. You've been in the trial every day. If you can talk about the significance of this and exactly what he's being accused of.
Sure. I mean, already, as you mentioned earlier, this is 2 years after the initial articles came out in The New Yorker and The New York Times. And already, for so many cases of sexual assault and rape, it's very rare for them to even make it to the trial stage. So that in and of itself is pretty historic. And then, of course, this is Harvey Weinstein, who's become sort of a figurehead of part of the anti or the Me Too movement. So already, that is pretty significant as a reporter myself sitting in the courtroom to see. As you were mentioning earlier, there are five felony counts against him. So that includes predatory sexual assault, first and third degree rape, and a forcible sexual act.
Now, six women have testified, but this case is particularly centers around two women.
Yes, that's
so correct. Explain that.
Sure. So the two women are Jessica Mann and Miriam Halley. Jessica was a former aspiring actress at the time that she met Harvey Weinstein, and Miriam Halley was then a production assistant. So essentially, even though the jury has heard testimonies from a total of six women, the accounts of Miriam Halley and Jessica Mann form the basis of the charges against Weinstein. So whether or not a jury finds the other women quote unquote credible or believable remains to be seen, but the charges are sort of specifically on their accusations. And interestingly enough, Annabella Shora, who was one of the first women to testify, although her accusations fall outside of the statute of limitations, her account is sort of being used for the by the prosecution to bolster the predatory sexual assault charge.
So let's go to the testimony of Jessica Mann. Sure. Explain what happened in court.
I think her testimony was one of the most, included some of the most violent accusations against Weinstein. You know, again, the one that he is being charged for in New York is that she's accused him of rape in a New York hotel. But for both of those accounts, she offered details that in many cases were different from some of the other women and the sort of violence that he that she's alleging that he used against her. So some of that included, you know, not letting her leave the room, slamming the doors, which she said, you know, taking her hands and forcing her to undress, using an injection in his penis and not using protection when having sex with her. These are all the things that she's alleged in her testimony. And so also, interestingly enough, compared to the other women who have come forward, her testimony and cross-examination was one of the longest. It spanned over 3 days, I believe, and cross-examination took 2 days. The first day, as you were mentioning, they had to be cut short early because she told prosecutors she was having a panic attack on stand. So it was one of the most emotional, I think, to witness from the audience.
And Miriam, the other woman in the case.
Yes. So she was a production assistant. She grew up in Stockholm, and basically she had been an assistant on Project Runway, which was a Weinstein Company-produced production. And her accusation was essentially that, you know, she had been invited to meet up with Weinstein in his Soho apartment. They seemed to be having a normal conversation at first, and then she has alleged that he sort of lunged at her, backed her into a bedroom, and then eventually orally sexually assaulted her.
I want to turn right now to what happened Tuesday. Weinstein's attorneys resting their case and saying their client will not testify in his own defense at his trial.
Well, Mr. Weinstein has been a very good client, so we didn't have to restrain him. But he was ready, willing, and able, and anxious to testify, to clear his name, to clear the facts of these cases. But Mr. Chironis and Ms. Rotuno, joined with the rest of the New York team, advised him that he did not need to do that because the evidence presented in this case was anemic at best. If his name was not Harvey Weinstein and it was John Doe, the Manhattan District Attorney's Office would have never brought these charges. The prosecutor has failed miserably to prove their case beyond a reasonable doubt.
That is Weinstein defense attorney Arthur Idala. Talk about the approach of the defense in dealing with these women and the case, and specifically what it means for Harvey Weinstein not to testify in his own defense.
Sure. So since day one, the defense has come towards this case saying all of these interactions or incidents were consensual. And what they've been trying to prove through cross-examination and also with their own witnesses that they called when it was their time to present a case was that, you know, at the time, these women had consensual relationships with Weinstein, but now X years later, they are somehow relabeling the situation or reimagining the situation. And to make this argument, the defense has pointed to a number of emails between the accusers and Weinstein that appear friendly, that, you know, after the alleged incidents happen, still shows them reaching out and trying to contact Weinstein. Now, the prosecution, on the other hand, has tried to, again, rebut sort of this argument that they were consensual by bringing on an expert witness, Dr. Barbara Ziv, who actually testified in the Bill Cosby trial as well. And she was going through the logic of, you know, actually it's a rather common response for survivors of sexual assault to want to stay in touch with their alleged abusers. It's not uncommon for them to, you know, send friendly messages, to even have consensual sexual relationships with them after. So it's this kind of juxtaposed dynamic between how the two teams are trying to portray these incidents that at the end of the day, we'll see which side the jury ultimately sides with.